Thanks for checking out Homestead today. Today I want to talk to you about resources on your homestead. If you have a wooded area on your homestead, those trees could be a valuable resource. Not only can they provide lumber for you to build things, they could also put a little coin in your pocket. Well, I'm standing on my homestead here, and I have several acres of trees that are nice sized logs, and I'm going to do almost like a triple purpose with it. One thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make some money off of it. Two, I'm going to make some lumber off of it. And three, I'm going to use it for small projects around my homestead, as far as like maybe fence boards or anything dealing inside of my house. Yeah, there's several things you can do with it. On some previous videos, I made a feeding trough out of sawmill lumber, and that come from wood off of the homestead. Didn't cost me anything other than some time, and plus I got paid a little money for it as well. So that's what we're going to work on today, and I'm going to show you some of the little tips and tricks that I use in order to be able to put some money in your pocket and also get some of the resources that you need for your homestead. Most of the trees that you want to try to use is hardwoods, like oaks and hickories, red oak, those type of things are the best for like local small sawmills. And 9 times out of 10, they'll do a horse trade with you. If you bring the logs in, they'll 9 times out of 10 either pay you for them and you just buy some lumber off of them, or either they will saw the lumber up for you. One of the sawmills that I deal with, he trades the logs in for lumber, or either just pays me. So let's knock a few trees down, get them dragged out of here, get them loaded up, head to the sawmill, and I'm going to try to talk to the owner of the sawmill, see if he can, shed some insight for future homesteaders, or if you're possibly a homesteader right now, some of the options that you could do when you go to the sawmills. Let's get started. Okay, we're about to get started. There's one or two things I want to point out that is very, very crucial when you're dealing with large, heavy timber. One, you need to make sure that you have saws that are capable to saw hardwoods, because those trees are very tough to cut at times, especially the size of the tree. If you have like a little yard chainsaw, that's not really going to do it. You're going to, it's not going to cut the tree fast enough. And on top of that, the wind could blow and tip the tree one way or the other, which is very dangerous. So you need to make sure you have a powerful enough saw in order to be able to do it. Another tip that I want to give you is to make sure when you go into the woods that you have two saws. Because, like I said, the tree, when you start cutting it, could be looking like it's going to be falling one way, and in actuality it's going to be falling another way. It's a very tricky thing in order to learn how to read a tree. So if you're not very experienced with cutting trees, I suggest not to cut anything really big down unless you got some experience. And if you are trying to learn, make sure you have another person with you in the woods at all time, and start with something really small in order to learn your saw, learn how to read a tree. Because if a tree sits down on the saw, it's going to pinch it, and then there you are. It could hem your saw up, and the next thing you know it, your saw is stuck and you have no way of getting it out. Also, make sure that you look above you at all the time, because they are little things up in the air called widowmakers. Those are sticks and branches that hang in the tops of your trees, and they could fall down and hit you. Personal protective equipment is really suited, hard hat. If you feel like that you're in a dangerous area, I suggest really wearing it at all times. I don't have mine on at the moment, but I do have it. But make sure that you have those face shields and possible the chaps that go on. If you're not that experienced with it, I suggest really getting those things, because they can save your life. This is a dangerous job that you would be doing, and anything can go wrong at any given moment. So, but also, like I said, two saws, and make sure that they're sharp. Try not to hit the dirt in them. Try not to hit any rocks. Another thing you need to look for in your trees is make sure there's no metal. If you cut trees out of your yard, 9 times out of 10, you know, if you bought the place, somebody has tacked a birdhouse or put some kind of wire, like a barbed wire across it. And that right there can dull your saw, if not break the blade, if not kick a piece of metal back in and hit you in the face or anywhere on your body. And another thing, the sawmills hate when you bring wood in with metal, and that could affect the, you know, the price of your money that you would be receiving from them if you're intending on selling it. Or either if you're having them cut wood for you, they might charge you extra because you had metal in it and it damaged their equipment. As you see right here, I have an old tractor that I use here. It's a 85 horsepower old tractor. If you have an old tractor on your homestead that is cosmetically not that beautiful, but it gets the job done and you don't mind taking it in the woods, this is something that you could use to help you get the wood out of the woods. I wouldn't suggest taking anything that's real pretty down in there, because limbs, all kinds of stuff, the stuff falls out of trees, hits it, it'll damage your tractor. So if you take pride in your tractor, I suggest don't take that into the woods. But I have an old tractor here, so I don't mind her getting some scratches and dings and little cuts and stuff like that. But be careful of what you run over, because it is a rubber tired machine, and you pop one of those things and you're gonna spend a little money. So meet Ethel. That's my tractor's name. This is one of the tractors that I own. This is my logging tractor. And everybody gives me a lot of laughs off of the names that I give them. I got one named Agnes, Ethel, and Gertrude. So this is Ethel. And she's been around for a good while, and she's still hanging in there pretty good. So she does some of the heavy lifting around here. But now that we get ready to get started, I'm going to show you a little tip on something. On your saw, let's get here. On your saw, when you check your saws out, let's see if we can get a close up here. The chains, they need to be nice and sharp. It's just a little discolored where I've been cutting hardwoods. But they need to be sharp. And if you don't know how to sharpen a saw, you could usually go to a small engine shop. They usually could sharpen them for you. But if you want to attempt to sharpen them yourself, I'm trying to find one here. Here's one right here. If you really look at your chain, they have little notches on the chains. Let's see if I can get down close enough. On this chain here, there's a little notch that goes in an angle. That is pretty much a guide there, that's where you need to run your file, and you need to run it this way at all times, and follow that point there, and make sure that the file on your saw touches all three sides of it. Here's a file here, but make sure that it sits in it, it beds inside of there just like so, and you push it forward through. I got one hand tied up, but you can see here, this is the angle that you need to be at, and you just run it right on through, and you do that until the underside right here is clean, and that you have a nice point. And then you also have a bevel. I don't know if you can really see it, but if you have a bevel here, and this underside right here is all beveled, kind of, it looks like a knife on this end and a knife on the side here. Those are the critical points of the chain on your saw, because the blade rotates this way, and when it rotates it on the bottom side, it's coming back this way, and that's what throws that that meat out of that saw, out of the tree, excuse me. So make sure that your saw is really, really sharp. Like I said, if you don't know how to sharpen a saw, you can take it to a small, or either at some agricultural stores that deal with the chainsaws, they have people that can sharpen a chain for you. They got little chain instruments that sharpen the chains for you. It only costs a few bucks, anywhere between, $3 to $6, if that, depending on the size of the chain, how many teeth it has. So I'm going to go ahead and get fired up and start knocking trees down. Hang tight. Okay, I've knocked a couple down thus far, but I want to demonstrate how to take one down, learning how to read it, and if it's not quite going to land where you want it to, I'm going to show you a trick. Is what you call notching your tree. It helps the tree be able to fall and place itself where it's more suitable and easier for you to get it out, especially if you don't have the equipment like a skidder or something like that to pull your log out of the woods with. It'll just grab it and go no matter where it's at, well, depending on the terrain. But when you look at your tree, you need to see which way it's leaning. If the tree looks like it's leaning, you know, fairly like coming, you know, away from you, and you look at the back side of the tree and it has a bunch of branches, but the side that is leaning towards doesn't have that many, 8 times out of 10 that tree is going to go the way that all the weight is, especially if there's leaves on the tree. The limb side is the side that's going to be pulling that tree that away. So that's something you need to be careful and look at. But I have this tree that's going the way I want it to go, but where it's going to land at, it's going to land on top of one of my trees that I've already cut down. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to, what the term is used, called throwing the tree. I'm going to throw the tree away from it. And in order to throw the tree, you have to notch it. And some people can get into dispute about how to do your notch. Some people do their notches, mostly in my territory, they do it from the top down. I don't. I actually notch mine from the bottom. And what the notch does is as you start sawing the backside of that tree, as the tree starts to lean, the notch will, on the bottom side, will, once the tree starts touching that notch, it will roll itself around and fit itself to that notch. And then it will follow that notch and then fall over. Most people, when they notch it from the top side, it still has a lot of meat up under the bottom side of it, and it could still go any way at that point. It could roll off, but if you have the notch on your bottom side, it helps it keep it from twisting on you. I'm not saying that it will prevent it, but it does help keep it from twisting. Maybe not as much, depending on, you know, how the tree is leaning. Then you might have to use a wedge and tap it in as you saw it to help it, you know, keep it going the way you want it to go. So I'm gonna show you how I notch a tree and throw one. Okay, now that's how I notched the tree out. As you can see right here, this is my notch right here. And that's where my tree went. So I pretty much lined it up exactly like I needed it for it to go. 9 times out of 10, it's not gonna work every time, but majority of the time it will, as long as you have a deep enough notch and it has a, you know, enough fall on it, so when the tree grabs it, it'll roll down on to pivot on it, and then it'll fall the rest of the way. And that's how you notch a tree. All right, I've been knocking several trees down, and it's going good thus far. I'm almost about ready to start dragging out once I finish up my limbing. And I usually measure my logs out. I drag so many logs out at one time. I want to show you a little tip on how to make sure that your saw is still sharp as you're cutting trees. If you'll take, as I was doing some limbing here, this sawdust right here that we got here, as you can see, is long and it's not real fine. This stuff right here is a good indicator to let you know that your saw is still sharp. Now, if you start seeing powdery sawdust, that means your saw is really, really dull, and it makes it hard. It works you hard, makes it hard for the saw to get down through the tree. But as long as you got this stuff here, that right there, that lets you know your saw is still sharp. Now, this is what I'm cutting here is a hickory tree, so it's a lot softer than a oak tree would be. You see it some on the oak, but you most of the time see really, really huge sawdust flakes that let you know that your saw is still sharp. But if you do see that long stuff that looks like shredded cheese, I advise you not to put it on your salad. But that lets you know that your saw is still sharp, and you know you haven't hit anything, and you don't have to go and sharpen your saw. So I'm gonna finish limbing up, and then I'm gonna start dragging out. Okay, now we got it all hooked up, as you can see right here, and we're heading off up to our yard. Okay, now that we've got our logs hauled up to our yard here, what we're going to do is get ready to size them out. Now, when you size them out, most sawmills require you to have them at a certain length, whether it be 8 foot, 10 foot, 12 foot, 14 foot, or 16 foot. Any one of those measurements, you need to add extra onto it, anywhere from 4 to 6 inches extra onto it. So that way they have something to square the ends of the logs off when they make the lumber. Now, in order to size them out, instead of using a tape measure, I use a measuring stick. And what I did was I took a stick that is pretty straight here, and I cut it 6 foot. And then on the stick, you can see these little notches right here, like where my thumb is. I've got 3 of them on there. I come 2 foot from this end, and I put a notch there, and then I put one at 3 foot, and then on the other end, I come from the other end and made a 2 foot mark on this as well. Now, the reason why I have one for 2 foot and 3 foot, for the 2 foot, if you take the stick and you lay it at the butt end of your log here, and you take it, flip it over one time. My saw was in the way. But if you flip it over one time, that means you have, that's a 12 foot piece right here to the end of this stick. And then what you do is you just make a mark a little bit extra, right, you know, just past it. It's about 4 or 6 inches or so. Now, if I wanted to make a 10 foot, I'd flip the stick over one time, and I would come to your last notch on your stick here. That would make it 10 foot. Now, this one right here is for 9 foot. The 9 foot is for when sawmills cut cross ties and you want to sell your logs for cross ties. The place I take it to requires you to have a minimum of 8 foot 8. So I just cut them off at 9 foot. So I made a mark for 9 foot on there. And then, you know, so forth and so on. You could do simple math. You flip the stick over one time, the first notch would be 8 foot, the next notch would be 9 foot, and the next notch would be 10 foot. And then at the very end, you'll have 12 foot. So 16 foot, you'll flip it over and do your math like that. It's really simple. But it makes it easy, so that way you ain't got to keep dragging a tape measure and hooking it and doing all of that stuff. So I'm going to size these out now, and then I got to get it loaded up. I had some rain come through, so it put me behind schedule. So things might be a little bit different. But I'm still in the process of getting these out to the sawmill. So let's get them sized down and get them on the truck and head up the road. We'll be right back. we're loaded up, heading up the road to the sawmill, and let's make the journey. And be careful when you're on the road with these things, because they can shift and twist and do all kinds of little crazy things. So be very, very careful when you get on the road with it. Okay, we're here at the sawmill. As you can see, I've already dumped my logs off. He's came and measured them. He's going to write me a check now. I asked him a few questions about some of the things that they look for, what would be good information to tell the viewers. And they said one thing you want to check on your logs to make sure there's no rotten spots inside of your logs. Make sure that there's no metal inside of your logs. And just be careful when you're cutting your trees down. Those are pretty much the basic things I've explained about the lengths. I've explained about, you know, your saw, about keeping it sharp. Basically, that's all it is to it. And I made a, you know, nice little penny off of these logs here, and I'm gonna trade some of it out for some lumber to do some things around the homestead, and I got some money from it. And that's been my time on Homestead today. Make sure you check out some more videos, leave some comments, and ask some questions. Until next time, check me out later.